Now, getting straight back into our agenda, with the evolving economy and digital transformation, global investors are paying close attention to the region's tech ecosystems and are investing heavily in them. Now, the question for the investors has moved from the decision about investing in Asia to how best to uncover the winners of the future. Next up is an investment spotlight fireside session titled The Age of Asiacentricity, Becoming the Investor's MVP. Let's welcome to stage our moderator for this session, T.R. Harrington, partner SOSWE, Program Director of Orbit Startups. And joining T.R. is Yinglan Tan, Founding Manager, partner of Insignia Ventures Partners.
All right. Well, Yinglan says he wants to make this a lively, controversial session, so hold on to your seats a little bit. Just by way of like a brief introduction, you know, I'm going to do a self-introduction, talk a little bit about my firm, and then I'm going to hand it over to Yinglan, and then we're going to dive into the questions. But I would be remiss if I didn't start off with a short plug for my friend William Balbin. Tonight at 7 p.m., we are having our demo day in Dubai, and anywhere on Facebook or LinkedIn or wherever you get your information, please check it out, our live stream. And with that, I'd like to briefly do a quick intro. So my name is T.R. Harrington, or if you are Chinese, Tang Weilong, right? I lived in China from 2004 until about 2016. And I'm a serial entrepreneur. After I exited my last startup, Darwin Marketing, in 2016, I was doing angel investing. I invested as an LP in a few funds. And finally, beginning in 2019, again, our mutual friend, William Balbin, recruited me to Orbit Startups. So Orbit Startups is a brief intro. What we do is that we help companies get global scale in emerging and frontier markets in Asia, Africa, Middle East, and the Americas. We've been investing in Asia since 2011 with over 300 investments in the region. We are backed by venture capital fund SOSV, which has $1.3 billion under management and is the most active seed and angel investor in the world. And part of what we do as a program is that we try to help entrepreneurs. And the help that we provide is we try to connect them with corporate partners, to do better with data-driven growth, and our network of investor partners, of which Yinglan and Insignia is one, so that's a perfect transition.
Thank you for the kind words, T.R. I'm so happy that we share some background in China. I think, now first of all, you know, great to see everyone here. I've been back in KL for 3 years. Love the entrepreneurial dynamism and energy. Happy to see many familiar faces and you know, new business models that has emerged in the past 2-3 years. So very happy to be here today to share some thoughts with you, T.R.
All right, awesome. Well, let's get off, start off with our first question today. And I mean, Yinglan has been involved with so many unicorns, right, since he started his investment career. I was very curious to start off with Caro, right? And in particular, I was recently in Thailand, as I told him, I noticed that Caro is like advertising there. So do you think that now is the right time for some of these Southeast Asian, you know, unicorns to expand out of their home markets and start looking at the rest of the region for the growth?
No, it's a great question. We know, we always think that the ideal company, right, which doesn't really exist, is a, well, Singapore headquartered company with Indonesia and Malaysia as home markets, with a Vietnam engineering team, with a Philippine call center operation, and we've been trying to find that company for a longest time. So I guess Caro was the closest we came to that. It was, I guess it was kind of incubated in my kitchen table. We saw the opportunity in used car. And actually, most people think they sell used cars, but the truth is that the transaction business is great, you know, but the margins are small. So you have to have a accompanying business, which is you know, lending and insurance, right? So every time you buy a car, you actually do trade-ins. You make money 4 times. So you sell, you trade in a car, you buy a new car, you take a vehicle loan, and you take mortgages. So I think we're starting to see a hybrid business model emerging in Southeast Asia, right, where it's not a pure transactional type business, but I would say a mutant, right? So I think the kind of business we have seen before were like 5 years ago, right? If you were the Airbnb or the Sea Trip of Southeast Asia, that would have sufficed, right? So these are the clones. I think now, 2-3 years ago, we saw the mutants, right? So, you know, that took different models, or you solve local problems using global business models, right? But solving it locally. I think now we're starting to see the emergence of new species, right? So, and these are solving local problems using local business models. I give you one example, which is a company called Fishlock in Indonesia. It's a relatively new investment. And from the surface, it looks like, you know, it's a pretty uninteresting company, right? It provides software for fishermen in Indonesia to do logistics, to do financing, to do ERP. But if you think deeper, you know, Muslims don't eat pork, right? So they, you know, fish is a big source of protein. And Indonesia, there's a big archipelago, you know, many thousands of islands. So fish logistics is actually quite complex. So if you combine the two, logistics for fish, software for logistics for fish, is actually quite an interesting market. And we sort of draw a 2x2, right? You know, sexy and complex. So a lot of the people...
I'd like to see you draw that.
So on the right side, sexy and complex is like Web3. Well, all the smartest and brightest people are in crypto, Web3. And actually, every time I talk to them, they are very tired. Because why are they tired? Crypto is 24/7, right? It's like you know, it's no weekends, 24/7. You know, if you want to compete, you want to be the best, you have to do that. So they're always tired. Yeah. So it's very crowded, competitive. But if you look at something like Fishlock, it's complex because like archipelago fish, but it's not sexy.
Right.
And that's actually where we spend a lot of time. We find a lot of these unobvious companies that tries to do something unusual.
Complex and not sexy. All right, I like that. Now, I think, first of all, how many people in here are looking for money? All right, we got some. How many people in here are looking for companies to invest in?
More people, I think.
Also relatively small hands. I think one of the most interesting things that would be, I think, for the audience in your case would be like, all right, you just mentioned like Kara was like a conversation over your kitchen table. That's quite unique, right? You know, you obviously knew like maybe like the founders is so ahead of time. But when it comes to maybe one of your more recent investments where you didn't know the founders ahead of time, what about the founders, you know, attracted you to make that investment, right? Maybe one of your more recent portfolios.
Yeah. So I think one of the things, actually, there's only one thing.
Okay.
They are pretty unstoppable.
They're unstoppable.
I mean, I do this and you know, some founders may not like it, but it's actually quite illustrative. I mean, Singapore has this place called Block 71, right? So it's like the, you know, like incubator where all the startups are. If you want to find where the best founders are, you just go there at 5 p.m. at Friday, 10 p.m. And actually, right. You know, if you go backtrack, right, all the good companies have emerged from Singapore.
Yep.
They are there taking the last bus home. You know, some of them even go figure out the time of the last bus.
Right.
And they time it so that they save some money taking the last bus home at 10 p.m.
That's
usually indicates success because building a startup is not easy because you're going against big incumbents, right? So you have to have, you know, you have to work hard, but not only that, you have to hustle, you have to be unstoppable. If you see a wall, you have to find a way to go around it, climb over it, crawl below it, or make friends with the wall, right? So I think that's one attribute. But I think the other one that we see is situational awareness.
Okay.
So they are able to see both the macro, what is evolving globally, adapt, but also be able to dive into the details quite well. And you know they treat their competitors as peers, not you know nemesis. They sort of treat them as you know, playing on a football pitch. You know this is like another team that I play against.
Right.
And I think the third is that they're able to. Recruit great talent, and I mean that in a way that I used to think that it was like you know founders think of their staff like family, but you know sometimes they condone you know non-performance or low performance. Then I thought the best founders are like wolves, but then you know there are lone wolves, there's wolf packs. I come to conclude that the best founders or, you know, the best teams that I back are more, they are more like football teams, right? So you want to be the, well, okay, some will argue this team is better than other, but okay, you want to be the next, you know, Real Madrid, Manchester United, you know, they are able to take one match at a time. If they lose this match, it's okay. They pick themselves up and they compete professionally within the rules and win. So I think those are some of the attributes that we have seen.
Okay, so it's like, you know, the founders who are going to put in the extra hours, right? They're not going home at 5. They're maybe not even going home at 10. Maybe they missed the bus, right? You know, they've got that sort of like viewpoint where they can see things locally, but they can also see things from a strategic standpoint, right? So those are, yeah, those are key, like in seeing, like you said, also how they work as a team, right? Who do they recruit to bring in? Because, I mean, you know, we invest in 40 companies a year. Every founder is always complaining, man, it's so hard, I can't find talent or how to get. And the ones who are most successful get through that barrier, find a way to get around, get over and get in, right? So yeah, I have 100% agree with those different points. All right, thinking about like Southeast Asia and the future, right? Or even Asia, the future in terms of, you know, where you think the market is going, what you are looking for in terms of like the next type of companies or type investors that you're looking in. Do you have any contrarian views? Do you have any views where you feel like your views are very against like what the market believes, right? But you're also, you feel very, very strongly about that.
So I think I have two or three views on this. One is that you have to do what makes sense. And a lot of things actually, you know, like at least actually last year or last 6 months doesn't make sense. So you do what makes sense. I think the other one is to not be too caught up by the hype. Right, and you know, be really top-down, thesis-driven. We don't really, you know, spend too much time crying over split milk on missing some companies that are deemed to be hot. Mm. I think the focus is to make sure our existing companies are doing well. Make sure we put in our whole resources to help them. I think we're quite unusual in the way we are set up. So we just closed our new venture fund, which is about $560 million. But I think we're one of the only venture funds in Southeast Asia that has an in-house engineering team. So we actually send engineers, which is a big problem in Southeast Asia, to our portfolio, help them with tech. We have a whole ecosystem now of 96 unicorn founders that, you know, they're our resource pool to tap, you know, ideas and, you know, due diligence, and they can understand a lot of what's happened in other markets. The third one that I thought was quite, we were quite happy with is this, we have this academy. And this was really inspired by, I think, some of the, you know, older people here, Manchester United class of 92, right? If you look at why Manchester United was a dynasty, they had this David Beckham, Ryan Giggs, Paul Scholes, you know, that class of 92. So we have this whole in-house academy, which actually now opened to the public, where we have now about 104 fellows, venture fellows at the academy. They learn about venture. They are senior professionals at Google, Stripe, Facebook, variety of places. They come with us for 12 weeks and we teach them about venture. Some start companies, some decide to be angel investors, some join us. And you know, we have like a 7.7% acceptance rate, which is actually harder than Harvard Business School to get in. We do no marketing, 99% inbound. So that's, I think, another interesting feature that we have added recently. I think the back to answering your question, I think the third one is to say that, hey, we are not very good at predicting the future, but we are very good at finding founders who can predict the future.
Okay.
So, and I think the future cannot be predicted because we can do a series of iterative venture-backed experiments that gives us some clue of what the future might look like. But I would say that tomorrow, well, the stock market go up or down, don't know, right? It's, you know, it's hard to predict the future, but I think A, we are good at finding founders who can predict the future, and B, I think we're good at staging our, you know, our investments in companies over time in a series of experiments that can sort of unfold and increase the probability of success.
Great. I just want to let people know in the audience, if anybody wants to ask a question, please line up behind one of the mics, and you know, when Yinglang finishes, we'll ask. All right, but. I know that some of you are hesitant to do so. I highly recommend you try, right? You know, he's got so much wisdom over here. Talking about another piece, and this is a question we talked about a little bit earlier, is that there's two things, you know, I think we share in common. Well, one is we both spent some time in China, right? So I'd be really curious to hear what your experience in China taught you or how it influenced the way you think about investing in companies. Right, because I mean, you talked about like, you know, the founders who stay late. China's famous for the 996. I personally went from Silicon Valley to China, and I felt like it was harder and faster, right, than where I came from. So I'd love to hear a little bit about like how your experiences in China kind of informed or influenced the way you think about investing.
Actually, it's quite interesting. So I think we almost intersected in China. I was there in 2003, 2004, right, which was arguably a similar stage to where Southeast Asia was in 2017, about the same, maybe plus or minus a few years. That's where it was really booming in tech, right? And you see companies like, once you have a company like Meituan, right? Group buying, there was a few thousand of these competitors.
Totally.
So, I mean, I think Southeast Asia, you have some of that, but not thousands.
Right.
Well, US, it hardly happens. If someone has a unique idea, there's no copycats, right? But here, you have, you know, a few, but not a few thousand. So the competitive intensity is so intense, like
absolutely.
Order magnitude different. Now, well, the good and bad news, however, is that given what is happening in China domestically, you know, I would say the A teams in China are coming to Southeast Asia. If they, I mean, their rationale is that, hey, if I can compete in China, I can come to Southeast Asia.
Yeah.
I mean, the first wave of Chinese entrepreneurs, I think they were not very adept in internationalization. The DNA was still, you know, China, competing against Chinese competitors.
Yep.
But the new wave, ByteDance, Shein, many others that are coming, they are of a different breed. Okay, so I think Southeast Asia entrepreneurs are in for intense competition that they have not faced. I mean, you start to see this in the MNCs already, right? Lazada, you know, they shifted. They're sending the A team here, right? You know, so you're going to see much more intense. But I think the other thing is also, for us as investors, also interesting entrepreneurs, opportunities, because we are starting to see global companies being formed. You know, they could be Singapore headquartered, but harnessing Chinese engineering teams, targeting, you know, the Southeast Asian market, and maybe let them. So yeah, I don't think you have to think of companies as a Malaysian company anymore. It's really arbitraging the global resources with this whole remote work, COVID. I think people have recruited globally. So I think you're able to harness the best globally, you know, and arbitrage the best talent. I think you can build a pretty interesting businesses in Southeast Asia.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really interesting observation, because one of my entrepreneur friends from China had started like a game company originally out of Beijing. And the second company, they decided to go to Southeast Asia like around 2017, like right around when you said that was happening. So there's definitely, like you say, the Chinese are coming, right? You know, they're coming to Southeast Asia. Now, one of the toughest things that I've ever had to do as an investor is to tell a founder who I really wanted to say yes to, I had to say no, right? And, you know, as much as sometimes you want to support them, you want them, sometimes you have to say no. So I'd love to hear about, like, if you've had any experience with that with your founders.
I think that's an easy one. I think the first company I wanted to invest, really wanted to invest in, was a little company. They was even called that current name, right? It was a little company called Garena. There was no Shopee. So, you know, I pushed really hard. You know, I think the founder wanted the auspicious number. You know, Asians here, they don't know 588, right? 88 is auspicious, right? Then
lucky.
I was in my previous firm, they want something like closer to 400. And 400 is like 4 in Asia is not very auspicious.
Yeah, no, 4 is a bad number.
No. So, well, it's a blessing in disguise. Then I said, okay, maybe I should start something myself. And 2017, that's where Insignia started. Arguably, you know, I would have not started Insignia if that investment had gone through. But then, I mean, now C is a great supporter of us, great partners. So that, I think that goes to say that, you know, in the startup community, you know, I think a lot of us, I was talking to folks, many folks like Ganesh, we are like the old generation, OG. And, you know, you see each other against...
Are you calling me old?
No, I just old, you're OG, so I'm just old. I think you see many familiar faces do different things. You know, founders become investors, then become founders again. So I think it's a multi-stage business. So, and that's actually what we tell the academy, right? I mean, for some of our younger investors, you know, don't try to optimize over one investment, because the journey is long, right?
Absolutely.
And also, you know, some companies, they try to IPO and, you know, squeeze every dollar out. You know, you try to leave, I think the best founders, they leave money on the table. So everybody makes money, you know, don't try to optimize the price at IPO, everybody wins, right? So I think that, I think is my learning in the past, you know, maybe decade in venture.
Yeah, because I mean, it's like, it's a long game. You want to have those relationships, you know, for the future. If you over-optimize, if you push too hard, you're going to damage the relationship, you're going to damage the trust, and then you won't have, like you talked about. I think it's really interesting that you set up that, like, foundation where you had all the ex, like, founders, right, you know, together to both as a source of ideas, but maybe even like a source of, you know, of new companies, right, and so on and so forth. And if you push too hard, right, you won't have that relationship anymore.
I mean, that, just to add on that, the other interesting thing that, you know, when we talk to all these guys who have built $5-10 billion companies, they always tell the younger founders, hey, don't try to optimize on valuation. Because if you look, okay, last 6 months, right, you see all the founders who raised high prices, they're in for a rude awakening, okay? Next 6-12 months is not going to be easy. Because we look at the data, and you can look at our website, we have all the data published on our tools, right? Series C and A is still on the high, but Series B has dropped 50%. The average price of a Series B was 120 million, now it's 60 million. Mm. Series C has dropped a little bit, 20%. Mm. Series D is still holding strong. I think there's a flight to safety. But I would think that if you give it one or two more quarters, you will see, you know, numbers probably falling quite significantly.
Okay.
So, and I would urge, I mean, the entrepreneurs in the audience, right? You know, valuation sometimes is a marker. It's temporary, okay. I think ultimately you want to find good partners, you need to get enough capital, and now we tell our founders you need to get enough capital for 3 years, right?
Right.
2 to 3 years, at least three ideally, two minimally, and I think that's, I would strongly urge for you to optimize on that instead of, wow, you know, 6 months ago, wow, no, there's, you know, seed round, no numbers, big vision, boom, 100 million posts, right? So I think those days are probably far and few between.
Yeah, so probably last question here, because we're running out of time, is, you know, going back to what you mentioned earlier, right, you know, you've recently raised like over 500 million, right, you know, for like your new funds. And you mentioned like this winter, right, especially in like the Series B area where the valuations you expect to drop. Do you see like yourself as slowing down any of your investments? Because certainly I've seen in China, they've slowed down like a lot of the investments, and in some other, you know, firms have slowed down their investments. Do you plan on slowing down, or are you gonna keep going?
It's funny you ask that. I used to carry a printer around Southeast Asia, those of you who know me. And now we actually made it better. We have a software on the cloud. So you go to our website, there's this tool, so you can print a term sheet. And
oh,
then
really?
There's a cap table calculator. And I mean, I was in Bali, oh, I mean, last week, and we made two investments like last week, right? So I think we are very, I think now is the best time to partner with great founders. I think you look at Airbnb, Uber, it was, you know, started 2013, right? Arguably, yep. You know, after a serious recession. So I think the founders who are still here after a very tough recession,
yep,
are the resilient ones, right? When the tide is, you know, subsides, you see who is swimming naked, and also it's very easy to see who is truly serious and can execute. I think 6 months ago, it wasn't, when there was a loss of capital, it wasn't that clear to see, that easy to see. But now it's quite clear to see who are the strong entrepreneurs. And actually, a lot of you that I met over the past 2 days, you know, wow, I mean, some of you have grown significantly over COVID. Some of you didn't even have a business. You started during COVID. But I mean, I see a lot of resilient entrepreneurs in Malaysia.
All right. Well, we've come to time. I hope you've taken a few insights away from Yinglan. And thank you so much to Yinglan for having this fireside chat with me.
Thank you so much, Tirao. I enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you, TR and Yinglan. That was an insightful session on investments in the region. In this next session, we'll be discussing the PropTech revolution powering up transaction models. Let's welcome on stage George Shimiel, the founder and chair of Juwai IQI.